The speed of light is 299,792,458 meters per second. Exactly. No, seriously. By coincidence? No, let me explain. The most successful measurement of C was done in 1972 using laser interferometry. Laser interferometry. Sounds familiar? Let me help you. LIGO. Laser Interferometer Gravitational Wave Observatory. Yes, the technology used to measure the speed of light was the same to the one used to detect gravitational waves. Here's how it went. Since 1862, we know, thanks to the work of James Clerk Maxwell, that light is an electromagnetic wave, and just like every wave, it satisfies this fundamental equation. The speed by which it travels through space is the product of its frequency and its wavelength. So all we had to do is measure the frequency and the wavelength of a beam of light and multiply them together. And that's exactly what we did. Actually, we only needed to find the wavelength, as the frequency was already known since the beam of light was shot from a laser which emitted a certain frequency. So how did we measure the wavelength? A laser shot a beam of light to a half-silvered mirror, which is a kind of mirror that lets part of the light pass through intact and the other part to get reflected. Then, these two beams hit a regular mirror, which always reflects it back, and then hit the same half-silvered mirror as before. And finally, parts of the two beams reach the detector. Now the crucial part is here. Since they both share the same path in the end, they can't help but interfering with each other. And there are two ways they can do that, either constructively or destructively. In the former case, the result is double the intensity of the light, and in the latter case, zero intensity. Now, you have to ask yourself, how much did I need to move one of the mirrors backwards or forwards in order to get from double intensity to zero intensity? 1 millimeter. Then the wavelength of the light is 4 millimeters. 2 millimeters. Then the wavelength of the light is 8 millimeters. And so forth. So we did this, we multiplied it with the frequency, and what did we find? A number between 299,792,455.1 meters per second and 299,792,457.3 meters per second, which means a 2.2 meters per second difference, which is not bad, but not good enough. You can also see that the number I said in the beginning of the video doesn't fall inside this range. The only reason why this uncertainty occurred, though, is because the definition of the meter at that time wasn't precise enough. At that time, meter was the distance of 1,650,763.73 wavelengths of the orange-red emission line of the krypton 86 atom in a vacuum. But that wasn't a good enough definition. In other words, there wasn't something wrong with the experiment that resulted in the 2.2 meters per second difference. It was the definition of the meter that was bothering us. So 11 years later, in 1983, the meter was redefined like this. Meter is the length of the path traveled by light in a vacuum in 1 over 299,792,458 of a second. So it's not light which is going by 299,792,458 meters in 1 second. It's the meter itself, the length which light travels in 1/this of a second. And as a consequence of that, we get that C is 299,792,458. meters per second. Measuring the speed of light has a long history. We went from rotating mirrors in 1926 to as far as uncovering a lantern and waiting for another person who is on the neighbor mountain to uncover his lantern in 1638. The latter method was Galileo's idea, by the way. But see, isn't just the speed that light happens to travel through the vacuum. Here are some examples to convince you that C is much more important than that. Number 1. C is the speed of gravity. Before Einstein came to revolutionize gravity, and Newton's law of gravitation was the standard, we thought that gravity was instantaneous, that if you remove the source of a gravitational field, all objects would immediately notice it and start moving like it's not there. But after 1915, we learned that that's not the case at all, and in order for gravity to influence an object, it has to travel at c towards it. There are some particles which are waiting to be found, and in quantum field theory, they are the ones which carry the force of gravity. We call them gravitons, and just like photons, they move at the speed of light. Number 2. In fact, all particles which don't have mass travel with C, and the primary, fundamental reason why they travel with C is the fact that they are massless. So, gravitons are massless, photons are massless, neutrinos may or may not be massless, we still don't know. Number 3. C is the fastest possible way two parts of the universe can talk to each other. If you wanted to send a message to someone, physics doesn't allow the message to reach the other person in less time than a light beam would reach them. So a much more descriptive name would be C is the speed of causality, as Matt from Spacetime says. But a question still remains. Why this? Why 299.792.458? Well, actually, nobody knows. C is a fundamental constant.